racing season is filled with ups and downs.
Dakota Armstrong will win at Talladega.
Highs and lows.
Into the wall goes the 55.
It's a journey that will test every competitor.
Four wide going through 1-2.
Both Buescher and Steve Arpin way up high.
It's man and his machine singing in perfect harmony.
Success and victory is his.
Man, awesome day, awesome day.
It's overcoming obstacles.
Problems, the 66 of Mark Thompson and Bill Baird in the 52. A hard hit.
It's about being in the right place at the right time. And for three drivers, Patrick Sheltra, Tom Hessert, and Craig Gose, it's about points. With two races to go, it's an all-out shootout to the end. Stick around. It's ARCA Racing from Kansas Speedway. Next.
We're just 3 miles to the west of downtown Kansas City. What an amazing season the ARCA Racing Series has already had. 11 first-time winners. Two of those are in contention for the 2010 championship. Welcome to the ARCA Racing Series presented by RE/MAX and Menards. It's the Kansas Lottery 150 on speed. Absolutely perfect day in Kansas City, Kansas, 75 degrees, sunny skies above. We are going racing today at Kansas Speedway. The last three races since Chicagoland started off with DeCoin. And there, it was Steve Arpin, who's had success already this season, and he wins on dirt at DeCoin.
Yeah, third win of 2010 for Arpin.
We move on to Toledo, the short track that Chris Buescher was successful earlier in the season, and he backs it up again.
Yeah, he's 17 years old. He's driving car 17. That's magic, Phil.
And then off to Salem, where Dakota Armstrong flexed his muscles, and he was the strongest car at the racetrack.
Yeah, the problem was in post-race inspection, his car was deemed a little low, as well as his teammate, Tom Hessert. You see right now, Tom Hessert, 15 points behind. That's because he lost 25 points at Salem. He would have been 10 ahead. Now he's 15 behind, but three guys within 20 points.
A great points battle in the ARCA Racing Series. Now let's go trackside to Jim Trado with one of the stories we'll be following today.
When we went into Chicagoland last time on speed, Mikey Kyle very much in the hunt for the championship. Finishes up 25 and 14th, though, however, has knocked him down to perhaps 200 points out of the lead. But for the umpteenth time, man, you're on the front row here in an ARCA Racing Series event. Mikey, talk about what the mindset is now, perhaps just going for the victory and really going full out.
Yeah, the deal at Chicago, I think, pretty much cost us for the championship. But we got the mindset now we're just going to win races. We've been fast everywhere, just hadn't had that racing luck, I guess you want to call it. So, the mindset is just go out and win races. And this is the car we won with at Michigan and led a lot of laps at Pocono. So it's been a real good race car. We'll go out there and take care of it and hopefully be at the end, be in victory lane.
With a proven race car, he also has his teammate Steve Arpin alongside at the front of this one, guys. Should be interesting at the beginning of this race. Let's check down pit road with Wendy Venturini.
Thanks, Jim. Only 20 points separate our top three guys going into the final two races in our chase for the championship in the ARCA Series. Patrick Sheltra, now with 15 points to your advantage, Patrick, how aggressive can you be today?
Well, you know, you got to be aggressive and conservative all at once. You just got to have a good finish. We didn't get to qualifying start that we wanted today, but really got to thank all these guys here on the Sheltra Motorsports team for coming here. We didn't test, and they fought it all day today, and we got a little bit better, and hopefully we have a good day today. Just want to thank Jones Groups and Tequesta Road and Bridge of Ferguson Pike for being with us this weekend.
All right, Patrick Sheltra, one of the guys going for the championship that opted not to test here, but he will roll off 10th. We'll see if it pays off when the green flag drops, guys.
Thanks, Wendy. Rick Allen, Phil Parsons, Darrell Waltrip with you as we come down to the final two races of the season. We just heard a driver say conservative. Have you ever heard a driver use the word conservative when he's leading by just 15 points?
Well, that one has to be conservative. All three of those guys have to be a little bit conservative. As a matter of fact, I talked to Eddie Sharp, who owns the car that Craig Gose drives right now, and he said, I'm absolutely racing those two other drivers here. With two races to go, we know how important this championship is. Eddie won last year with Justin Lofton. He knows how to win it. He said, we have to be concentrate on what those other two guys are doing.
I was really shocked when they said there was a penalty for cars being too low at Salem. I've been there, Phil. That thing is like Bristol. It's really, really rough. So those points, that 25 points that Hesher got taken away from him, pushed him back to second place, makes it even that much more exciting.
Remember, last year was decided by 5 points, one finishing position throughout the course of the year.
And it could come down to being closer than that at the end of this one. Again, two races left in the 2010 season. Rockingham will determine it next weekend. But we've got a great one in front of us here at Kansas Speedway. Who will get to victory lane? Stay with us. We'll fire the engines next. Coverage of the ARCA Racing Series on Speed is brought to you by RE/MAX. Find your dream home at RE/MAX.com. And by Menards. Save big money at Menards. And welcome back to Kansas Speedway. A gorgeous afternoon for racing as we see the cars beginning to roll off of pit road. We take a look at our Bombardier starting grid. Mikey Kyle grabbed the pole earlier today. Steve Arpin will be on his outside. Teammates side by side there in row number one. And Frank Kimmel, who's still in this mathematically in this championship, will start on the inside of row two.
That'll gain him 5 points. ARCA Racing Series gives points to qualifying 10 for first, 15 for first, 10 for second, 5 for third.
Young Ty Dillon starts on the outside of row number two, and that number 41. There's another one of our championship competitors, Craig Gose in the 81, currently third in the championship coming into this race. He's 20 points back.
There's Casey Roderick back in row number eight. He won on the road course in New Jersey, driving for Bill Elliott and James Finch.
Tom Hesser back there in row number nine, currently second in the point standings. He'll have his work cut out for him as he will try to get back to the front.
How about Bobby Gerhardt back in row number 11? If we were at Daytona now, he's a guy that you have to keep your eye on.
Or
but
Talladega.
But a good racer everywhere.
Most definitely. Nick Igdalski will start on the inside of row number 14.
See Rob Jones back in row number 15. He's a pilot for UPS by trade.
Lelani Munter in the 59 will be on the outside of row 17.
James Hilton back there in the back of the field. I raced with him in my rookie year in 1972 at Talladega.
Let's take a look at our Ansel track description. Kansas Speedway.
You see this racetrack, Darrell, the corners are a little flatter than some of the other mile and a half, so we go to only 15 degrees in the corners.
Yeah, it makes it a little more treacherous. Got to handle it. The car's got to really handle good here to go fast.
See our pit window somewhere around 60 to 70 laps here. Just long enough that I don't think you can make this you can certainly make it on one pit stop.
And we want to ride along with a few different drivers. One of those will be Lelani Munter. She drives the number 59, and actually, she had a little bit of a rough ride earlier today. This is a backup car because during practice, Lelani was going into turn number one, had a little bit of a wiggle, and that wiggle sent her up into the wall, and so she backed that car into the wall in turn number two.
Watch this ride along with her right here. Now listen to this throttle.
It sounded like she never got all the way out of it, never let the car take a good set. I think that's what got her in trouble. That's where that wiggle came from.
Operation Free on board with Lelani Munter.
We're also going to ride along with the 75 of Benny Chastain in the AARP Ford for Bob Shack Racing. Benny will start in the 30th spot.
I don't feel too good about AARP. I just got my car the other day.
I thought James Hilton would probably have that sponsorship, he being in the 70s.
And we're going right along here with Joey Coulter. He's starting in the 5th position, and just a good guy to keep an eye on because that 16 car is pretty fast.
Up front on the front row, starting second, will be Steve Arpin. We've got a camera riding along with him, so we'll have some great pictures from the front and the back of this field. Want to take a look at our ARCA spotlight. We'll shine a spotlight on a few different drivers. Today we're talking about our three championship competitors. Wendy?
In two races, we'll know exactly who that champion will be in the ARCA series. Craig Gose will start seventh today, 20 points back coming in to these final two races. He's finished sixth or better in our last six speedway races, so his record's been good on these mile and a half racetracks, but Craig Gose has to be consistent, but he also has to be a little bit aggressive in order to gain that points lead once we leave Kansas.
And Wendy, a driver that's sitting second in points, had the lead for about an hour after Salem Speedway's run. But again, that 25-point penalty for the height infraction has put Tom Hessert second in points. He's 17th on the grid, but he said, this is my favorite race car. He won with this car in Iowa, and Hessert certainly has got consistency on his side, as well as four cars they brought here to the test last week, and his teammate with a Penske Racing affiliation, Parker Kligerman, also helped him shake these cars down. Phil, so I think Tom Hessert is lowered for bear.
Jim, I want to take a look at our point leader, Patrick Shelter. A great breakout year for Patrick. 15 points up right now on Tom Hessert. Went back-to-back wins at Chicagoland and DuCoin this year. 15 top finishes in the 18 races. Talked to Patrick before the race. He said, we want to do our best here. The car wasn't great. We made some changes. Hopefully, we'll have something for him today. He will start back from the 10th position, DW.
You know, Phil, as we look at our nine-time champion here, Frank Kimmel, I just don't know if he can make it. I got good news. He gained 5 points today because he qualified up front. But he's 150 points back, two races to go. That's a big task for a nine-time champion. So I hope he can do it, but got his work cut out for him.
Mathematically still in it, but realistically, he's out.
Yeah.
Stay with us. When we come back, the green flag will fly for the ARCA Racing Series. Again, two races remain in the 2010 season. Welcome back to the Kansas 150 for the ARCA Racing Series. The field all in line. Let's head back to pit road for thoughts before green. We'll start with Jim.
I mentioned the Cunningham Motorsports team in bringing four cars and Parker Kligerman to the test. While starting eighth in the number 22 machine is Dakota Armstrong. The winner at Salem Speedway has brought the car that Kligerman won with here last year at Kansas. So indeed, Dakota Armstrong starting eighth, looking for maybe top five in points. He's got a great shot at it, Wendy.
A senior in high school, 18-year-old Ty Dillon, makes his second start in the ARCA Series. He finished second last time out at Iowa. He's hoping to duplicate much of those results, if not better. This team is coming off a win in the E-Series at Gresham Motorsports Park. On the pit box, veteran winning crew chief, Cale Gill.
And the field now all in line, ready to come to the green. Green flag flies. We're underway in Kansas.
Start by Venerini, teammates up front. Mikey Kyle on the inside, Steve Arpin on the outside.
Side by side as they go through one and two. Mikey Kyle will have the advantage as they go down the backstretch. Kyle in the 25, Steve Arpin in the 55.
DW, a lot of these guys talking about these cars being wicked loose, full of fuel right now until you get a few laps on the tires.
Phil, that's what you always worry about. They drop that green flag, you dive off in that first turn, and you say, oh, Lord, please let this thing be under me, because that's about the scariest part of the race, first couple laps.
You know what? An interesting sound that we hear in the ARCA Racing Series is when they hit the chip. The Mallory ignition systems limit these cars to 8,800 RPMs, and we're hearing that right about the time they cross the start-finish line, they hit that chip.
Yeah, these cars will actually slow down probably a second or half throughout the course of a run here, maybe even 2 seconds. So when, in order to have that good RPM down the straightaway, they're going to hit that chip early. Well, Casey Roderick already to pit road.
Casey Roderick started 16th in this race, and the caution is out. We got problems in turn number two.
I think a lot of that started on the start of the race, actually. There were some cars about mid-pack that just didn't get going. I believe that was one of them.
Brad Smith in the 26. Slow on the racetrack through turn number two, and so the first caution comes out in Kansas.
It's going to be a big break for Casey Roderick if they can figure out what's wrong with that 51 car.
I never like when I see the hood up. You know, the first lap of the race, you're in the pits here with the hood up. That's not a good sign.
Again, Brad Smith in the 26, making his way through three and four, and will come onto pit road, as we talked about and showed you earlier. The 51 of Casey Roderick right away came onto pit road. They lifted the hood up on that race car.
They've just closed the hood. We'll see if he can get back underway here in order to not to lose the second lap, but looks like he's not going to be able to do that. He will stay on pit road and lose the second lap.
This is the start of the race.
About mid-pack here.
Right in there is a 51 on the outside. He's not under power right now,
yeah,
DW.
The car's just not going, and of course you can see what it did. It really bottled everything up right there from him on back, and I noticed that on the start. I looked down into turn one, and half the field was missing.
This is turn number two. That's Brad Smith in the 26.
Right in the middle of our screen. He's going to back up the racetrack. Nice job by that car avoiding him.
Remember what I told you about, oh, Lord, please let this thing stick? It didn't.
And that's bad news for Casey Roderick. They push that 51 back and will put him behind the wall. Stay with us. More from the Kansas 150 here on Speed. And coming up next, it is NASCAR Race-Up. Steve Burns will get you caught up on everything going on in the world of NASCAR. Bob Dillner has an update from here in Kansas. And we, of course, will get Mr. Excitement, Jimmy Spencer's take on quite a few things.
My man Steve Burns is knocking it out of the park every afternoon.
Also an update on the RCR appeal. That has been the big story of NASCAR as of late. And the field coming back to the green flag. Mikey Kyle, a good restart. Right behind him, his teammate Steve Arpin. 1 and 2. And we have nine-time champion Frank Kimmel in the 44, just behind him in third.
We had another car about 12th or 14th back. Looked like he was had trouble getting up to speed, DW.
Yeah, a bunch of these guys are really struggling on the starts. I tell you, when you're on a tri-oval like this, you've got to protect that right side because somebody can slip up there between you and the wall and get by you. But I think that may have been what went on with a couple of those cars. Had to get back a spot.
Championship contenders here, Craig Gose, Patrick Sheltra. Gose coming in third. He's 20 points back from Patrick Sheltra, who is your points leader.
Patrick's going to make a move to the inside. He's going to be dead even when we get to the start-finish line.
Battle for position on the racetrack. Sheltra and Gose battling for that seventh spot. Sheltra takes it away from Craig Gose.
29 is Chad Finley right behind Craig Gose. A lot of the talk in the garage that he was one of the best cars in race runs. That's the car that Brad Keselowski owns. Mikey Kyle still out front here, about 3 or 4 car lengths over his teammate Steve Arpin. There's Frank Kimmel right now running in the third spot. Ty Dillon back to fourth.
7th and 8th. Craig Gose running in the 8th spot. Just behind him in that number 29. That is Chad Finley.
Chad tries to work his way to the inside. There's another Chad behind him, Chad Hockenbrough, in the 58 car.
That 58 car is on the move. He's passed a number of cars. He's really handling well and got some power in the hood, looks like.
They had a great run going at Chicagoland. DW cut a right front tire down as we see Chad Finley work to the inside of Craig Gose.
Now, it's not illegal to go down below the white line here on this racetrack. Not that Daytona and Talladega, you couldn't do that. But here, you'll see guys running down on an apron through the travel here on the front straightaway.
No out of bounds at Kansas Speedway. Let's go back down to Wendy Venerini.
Casey Roderick, one of our winners from 2010 in the ARCA Series, finds himself behind pit road early on lap number one. Engine troubles for Casey Roderick. Now, keep in mind, earlier today, they've already changed engines on this machine. 5 laps into practice this morning, they had trouble, had to change engines. So it seems to continue on and be a theme for the 51 crew. Jim?
Things are much better for the driver running second in the Mike's Hard Pink Lemonade number 55 machine. Steve Arpin brought the Texas winner here to Kansas. Very comfortable in this race car, but he said in practice, again, that was this morning. In practice, he said they were really having trouble coming off of turn 4. So they worked on the free off condition, but then it got tight in the center. They made a bit of a gamble in qualifying. This setup is coming in. The crew just reminding him, take care of that right front tire in that 55 machine.
Great battle for third here behind our top two. And that is going to be the 41 of Ty Dillon making the pass on Frank Kimmel. So
I don't know.
Young Ty Dillon's getting up there.
He did, but he carried it in that first turn to make that pass. She went up the hill with him, and I thought Frank was going to cross over and get back by him, but looks like that Dillon car's got some power under the hood there, Phil. He's going down that straightaway.
Sure is. There's Chad Finley. He was able to get by the 60. Our point leader, Patrick Sheltra. That moves Chad up into the 7th spot. Patrick back to 8.
We've talked a lot about our points championship and being so close. Well, we have a gentleman who's joining us in the booth who is a part of one of the closest finishes in ARCA Racing Series history. And you actually entered the last race. This is Justin Allgaier joining us. You were 4th in the point standings into the last race and won the championship.
We did. It was a great weekend for us. You know, we were able to win the race and win the championship. And earlier I heard you talking about Frank Kimmel and being mathematically still capable of winning. And that's all you guys were saying about me whenever we went into that last race. So
that's right.
You can't ever count anybody out, that's for sure, especially here in the ARCA Series.
And especially Frank Kimmel. No way would I cut him short. 150 points, that'd be a miracle. But Frank's pulled out some miracles in those 9 championship years.
There's no question.
Kimmel running in the 4th spot now on the racetrack. Kimmel's had success on this racetrack before. been able to find victory lane in Kansas. Justin, you've got a little bit of a vested interest, actually, in this race. Well, your family's still a part of the ARCA Racing Series?
You know, one of the really cool things about the ARCA Series is the fact that it's been part of my family for a long time. And, you know, having a team, my dad still owns a team that runs here, the number 36 that's on the screen there, Rob Brent. They've been doing a great job. And you know, they were fortunate enough to get in victory lane at Pocono earlier this year. So, you know, most of the guys are pretty much still the same guys that were on my team in 2008 when we won the championship. And it's definitely a fun series, and I know that our guys really enjoy it and couldn't imagine being anywhere else.
I tell you, when I knew this guy could drive over here, when we were at Eldora. Now, he had just won. I think he'd come off the Bristol win, and I was kind of impressed with that. It was a pretty tough place to win. But when I saw him wheel that dirt car around Eldora, I said, that boy can drive, buddy.
Well, I appreciate that. It's we have a lot of fun with it, that's for sure.
There's Justin Marks, the 32 car on the outside. Patrick Shelter, the 60 on the inside. That is the battle for the seventh spot.
Side by side, door to door, is Sheltra able to get by that 32 of Justin Marks. Amazingly enough, this season we have seen 11 first-time winners, one of them being your driver. Rob Brent got his first win this year. This series really does develop great talent, and you are a perfect example of that, now racing in the Nationwide Series.
Well, thank you. I think, you know, the one really cool thing about this series is the fact that, you know, we're here in Kansas. I mean, this is a big mile and a half. We go anywhere from little old, you know, bull rings to all the way up to the big mile and a half, 2 miles, Talladega, Daytona, road courses. You get all kinds of stuff. So it's really nice to be able to get out there and run on the radial tires and, you know, carry the speeds that they're running. And I think that's the reason why you see guys like Ty Dillon, for example,
right,
you know, coming and running this series. It's a great development series. And I think that you're seeing that week in and week out.
Out in front of the field, it's Mikey Kyle. Since the drop of the green flag, he's been able to pace the field. Steve Arpin running in the second spot. Ty Dillon, Frank Kimmel, and Joey Coulter, your top five. Tomorrow, four-time NASCAR Sprint Cup champion Jimmy Johnson stops by the biggest party in racing from this NASCAR trackside from Kansas tomorrow at 7 Eastern, right here on Speed.
A.J. Allmendinger will be there, too. Boy, he was running good last week at Dover, wasn't he, D.W.?
Man, he got two laps down and was able to make that up and still get a top 10. That was an impressive run. And right after an impressive run, I read where Richard Petty said, you know, we might run three cars next year. Of course, if they ran like that every week, I'm pretty sure he would.
You know, Allmendinger led more laps in that race than he had in his career. Pretty good numbers.
Allmendinger,
I'm sorry. Yeah.
They're
Allmendinger.
So close.
Yeah, I was looking at Justin. Yeah. I was right. Talking about Allmendinger.
I wish I could have led that many laps. Yeah. It looked pretty good. I'm not gonna lie on that one.
Well, you could have if you'd have been in the race, Justin.
If I'd have been in it, yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Battle for the fourth spot now. You see the 29 of Finley.
We talk about Chad Finley being really good in practice, Rick, and he is really on the move. Qualified back in the 12th spot and made his way already up to fourth now.
You know, pretty much every time that they've run that car, they've been really successful. It seems like they've always kind of, you know, bit with some gremlins. You know, they've not really finished where they've run. So, you know, hopefully if everything stays together like it should, they should be up there running and contending for the win.
That is so disappointing when you have a fast race car. You get in there and you get a chance to win or get a chance to get a great finish and a gremlin gets you. You know, sometimes with the car, you get in a wreck. Boy, that just takes, it's so disappointing.
Sixth and seventh, Patrick Shelter on the inside of Joey Coulter.
Looks like he's going to be able to make the pass. Looks like Patrick's going to try to get that thing up front here to keep that point lead. Right now, he's the highest placed car of our 3 point leaders.
Yeah, and I like what he's doing, Phil. He's not pushing. He's not forcing the issue. He's really driving a pretty conservative race right at this point.
Started in the 10th position and has made his way up to sixth now. Again, Mikey Kyle set the fast lap time at 33.755 last time by, but his pole was just in the mid 31 seconds. So we're already seeing about a 2 second drop off on these tires per lap as we've completed 21 laps.
But just remember, right now Mikey Kyle is not racing anybody. Mm-hmm. He's kind of got a comfortable lead and he's just running a pace almost right now, just trying to stay out front.
There's Miguel Peluto behind the 36 of Rob Brent. Miguel Peluto, we see him frequently in the K&N Pro Series.
Looks to the outside of Justin's family car there. Miguel had a great debut in the Truck Series at Bristol with a top 10 finish. Also had a great run at Loudon. Here's Chad Hockenbrough going underneath Joey Coulter. That's a battle and a change of position for seventh.
One thing that's really cool about Miguel is the fact that he really has a very limited experience on ovals. And I think, you know, him being able to take to the ovals as well as he had, I think it says a lot about his talent behind the wheel of a race car. So I was actually, you know, really interested in seeing how he's going to do in this race and seeing how far up in the standings he can get.
That's a great team he's with. That's Germain Racing that's fueling this car, the same team that he runs, obviously, for in the Truck Series, as well as the K&N Pro Series East Division, which just finished their season up last week at Dover.
And congratulations to Ryan Truex on winning his second consecutive championship. Oh, we got smoke coming out from underneath that 29 of Chad Finley. You guys talked about the Gremlins, and here they come again.
Fast car running up, making great moves, coming up through the field.
That has a terminal look about it, doesn't it, DW?
Yes, sir. That smoke coming out from under the hood and the fenders like that, that's not a good sign. And now coming out the back. So, yeah, she let go.
Such a shame.
Had a third-place finish at Pocono earlier this year, and that was his best.
Yeah, he's going to the garage.
Yeah, he's gonna make that left-hand turn.
As my old friend Sterling Marlin would say, she blowed up.
Yeah.
Just came out of turn number two, and you saw the smoke begin to roll out from underneath the hood and the back of that one.
Tough break. Tough break for that Brad Keselowski team.
Difficult day for Chad Finley. Justin, thanks for joining us. We appreciate it, and good luck to you this weekend.
Thank you guys very much. Thanks for having me on.
Good luck, buddy.
I got to get me a nickname.
Yeah, you do.
Gator. I like that commercial. That's a good spot. Guy who's out front, Mikey Kyle, he's liking his view right now. Sunday NASCAR race day storms into Kansas. Mark Martin joins us live. Plus, Jimmy Johnson talks about his dominant performance in Dover. NASCAR race day built by the Home Depot, live from Kansas. Sunday, 10 Eastern, only on Speed. We have completed 26 laps, and out front is still Mikey Kyle, our championship leader, running in the fourth spot now, as Patrick Sheltra has taken that position away from Frank Kimmel.
This car, the 60 car here, just keeps every lap it gets a little bit better and a little bit better. He's really got a nice long run setup in this car, which is what you want when you're trying to make laps and get points.
He wants to go to Rockingham with a little bit of cushion, D.W.
I don't know in this series what a little cushion would look like. Those first five guys are all over each other, the first three particularly.
We had a great time. We were able to stand down in the garage and talk to really the three championship competitors, and they stood all together, and we joked about, you know, are you nervous? What are you thinking about going into this race? And pretty much to a man, they said, not really nervous. As soon as the green flag drops, you know, that's our most comfortable time.
Yeah, so it is. You clear your mind. You get behind the wheel of the car. Really, probably the only thing you ever think about is if something happens to the car. You know, an engine failure like we saw there a moment ago in the 29, some tire failure, something that you can't control. Otherwise, you feel pretty comfortable.
I tell you, Chad Hockenbrough on the move right now. Just got
like
by Frank Kimmel, yes, for the fifth position.
I've been watching him. He started way back, and he's been passing a lot of race cars.
Craig Olsen, the 81. He's running in the ninth spot right now.
There's Patrick Sheltra, Chad Hockenbrough. There's Frank Kimmel going by the start-finish line. There's Joey Coulter. There's Chad McCombie right behind him, I believe.
And there's Craig Gose in that number 81 Toyota.
You know, Rickville, used to, you could win a championship just by being consistent, finishing races. It wasn't necessarily that you had to win a lot of races. I think that's all different now. I think in order to win a championship, you've got to have a winning race car. You can back it down, but you can't speed it up. And that's like Frank, nine-time champion, but he hadn't won a race. And so he's out there finishing them and getting the points that way, but he's not winning races.
Wendy, do they sound like they have a championship race car today?
Well, Craig has been pretty quiet on the radio, but who hasn't been are the crew chief and the spotter. They're trying to get Craig to work the bottom line. They say when you drift it in, that's when you're losing time. Hunt the bottom, get to that white line in order to get those faster speeds that Craig Gose desperately needs right now. He's ninth, had started seventh, but of course, as we go through every lap of this race, we're going to be looking at points, and right now he's tied for second with Tom Hessert. Jim?
And the guys in the booth, you just mentioned about long runs coming to Patrick Sheltra. One other benefit, he said the hardest driver he was going to think about watching to run with him in longer runs, the guy he was worried about, was Chad Finley. So Shelter now not only getting that additional boost for Finley having those issues, but as he's running here, he's getting faster, 1/10, 2/10 most behind our race leader's pace here. So Shelter's team very relaxed right now. But again, his biggest worry about long run racing is in the garage.
This is getting a little dicey right here. That 16 car, by the way, look on the hood of the 16. It's got the Darrell Gwynn Foundation on the hood. Darrell Gwynn does great things, and man, these guys are mixing it up.
Justin Marks in the 32 car. There's Craig Ghost right in the middle of that in the 81. Craig Ghost decided, I need to get by these guys. If they're going to race door to door like that, I don't want to be anywhere near them.
So he makes the move by the 32 of Justin Marks. Wendy.
Justin told me before this race that after the test session here at Kansas, they took their chassis back, put it on the pull-down rig, and changed everything on this race car because he didn't feel it tested very well. Well, here when we return to Kansas, it's a one-day show. It's a quick turnaround, and you really got to work on your setup. Justin Marks is super loose at the start of this race, especially in 3 and 4, so not too happy right now with the setup, even after they made all these adjustments to the chassis and to the setup of this race car. After their test session, Justin Marks started 6th, and he will have a long day in front of him. As it sounds like we have trouble on the track.
Well, very close to it.
No, we just have trouble in the booth. It's close on the track, though.
It's like Birdie. Tom Birdie with a flat left front tire.
There he goes.
We saw the smoke coming out from underneath the 15. It looks as though he cut the left front tire, and almost up into the wall he went.
Yeah, you can see damage on that left front fender, Rick, and I think that's what cut that tire down.
He's going to make it to pit road, fortunately, but he did make contact with the 16 of Joey Coulter right in the middle of the back straightaway.
No caution. We're clean and green, so he got that thing on pit road pretty fast.
Joey Coulter, Greg Ghost.
You can see the left rear tire on the 16 car there where they made contact.
No letter.
I'm a little worried about that. Let's see what happened here, guys.
See, the tire blew out. DW, you see it right there? Then when he did, he lost the front end of the car. He ran up and made contact with that 16 of Joey Coulter.
Yeah, he had made contact with somebody earlier because the fender was pushed in. That's what cut the tire down.
So they changed the tire for Tom Birdie, fill it back up with fuel. They'll put him back out on the racetrack, but he will now be a couple laps down to our race leader, Mikey Kyle. After the checkered flag here, stay with us. Steve Burns will bring you NASCAR Race Hub. They'll be talking about the RCR appeal from the 33 car and how NASCAR decided on that penalty.
You know, I watch Burns every afternoon, and that show has a comfortable feeling to it, kind of a down-home feeling. And Burns, he knows this sport. He knows everybody in it, and he really brings a really special effect to that show.
Right along right now with Joey Coulter. Looks like Chad Ghost able to get by him. But, you know, we're talking about the RCR appeal. It was denied yesterday for the 33 of Clint Bowyer, and I don't think RC was real happy about it.
No, he was very unhappy because he had spent a lot of time and a lot of money reproducing what he thought had happened. They had took a car to the Charlotte Motor Speedway and actually ran the wrecker into the back of it over there, and they had a guy that recreates crashes
for insurance companies,
a doctor, somebody, and Richard thought he had a good case, but
we got a lot of smoke here out of the 36. Is that left front tire rub that we're seeing, or do we have maybe an engine problem?
I don't see any problem with the left front, Rick.
I don't see any damage on that left front.
No damage.
A lot of smoke coming out from behind the 36. It looked like it was rolling out behind, or also from the left front a little bit. There's some smoke coming out the back.
Yeah.
Here's the first time we've seen Tom Hessert. Tom has made his way up to the 10th position. One of our point contenders came in this race second, 15 behind, after that 25-point penalty from Salem.
Justin Marks looked to the outside of Joey Coulter. Now he's going to duck back into the inside.
Tell you one thing, this little race is zipping along. Coming up on 40 laps.
Closing in on the halfway point of this one. 40 laps complete.
Just one caution so far, right?
First caution came out for the 26
right
of Brad Smith.
Second lap or so.
So Tom Hessert trying to make his way up toward the front with his other championship contenders. Patrick Shelter currently running in the 4th position. Craig goes in the 7th spot, and Tom Hessert back there in the 10th position.
Joey Coulter just lost that spot just now to Justin Marks in the 32 car.
Again, our pit window is in the 60 to 70 lap range, but will we see these guys not chance it go that long and maybe come in a little bit earlier if we stay green?
where you don't want to be caught on you don't want to be caught on pit road, or after you make your pit stop and the caution were to come out, it doesn't have to be the leader that can put you behind. It can be the guy running 10th or 12th that can put you behind.
36 of Rob Brent makes his way onto pit road. We saw smoke out from under that car. What is the problem down there, Jim?
No oil pressure for the car that Justin Allgaier said his family's still involved in. As a matter of fact, Gator's on the box. That's Justin's dad, and they're watching Dave Liner call the car in. Rob Brent coming in again. No oil pressure. This young man brought the car that won at Pocono. They thought they'd have a really good shot here at Kansas Speedway. They tested. They liked this car a lot better than the one they brought to Chicagoland. And unfortunately for these guys, oil pressure issues have caused that puff of smoke. They'll change forward, just taking things a look. Guys?
Yeah, Miguel Peluto in the 17 also with problems. He brings his car onto the pit road, and you see the damage on the right side. Looks as though he brushed up against the wall.
He flat-sided that right side of that Stimco Toyota.
You know, Phil, it's getting late in the year, and a lot of these cars, a lot of these drivers' engines, they don't have the budgets that the Cup guys do, or even the Nationwide guys, truck guys. They run their equipment until sometimes it breaks, and that may very well be what happened to the 36 car.
You run into the wall, it can break things too.
That'll break.
That actually damages
more
some
than
things
the car.
Also. Breaks your spirit sometimes too. Mikey Kyle has been dominant. He has a 2.3 second lead over Steve Arpin. Again, those two teammates running 1 and 2. Ty Dillon was able to make his way up into the third spot, but he's 6.5 seconds behind race leader. Then Patrick Sheltra in fourth, and Chad Hockenbraugh in the fifth spot.
Watch that car right there. That's Miguel Peluto as he comes off. Ooh, got a little bit loose up off of two and ran out of racetrack,
yeah,
DW.
It looked like the car kind of took off with him, put a little extra wheel into it, and then it snapped and hit the wall. And we were talking about his limited experience on ovals, and sometimes that's what happens with you, limited experience.
Mikey Kyle sat on the pole. He has led all of our 44 laps from the Kansas 150. Stay with us. We're closing in on the halfway point. Second caution has come out here in the Kansas 150. This time it's Chad Hockenbraugh. He got into the wall, and it looks as though a right front tire gave way on him.
Yeah, Chad was running up in the top five. You see him in running fifth right behind Patrick Sheltra. Yeah. You can see he feels something go wrong, and you can actually see the rubber flapping before he got to turn three. The good thing was he was so close to the outside wall, Darrell. It didn't do a great deal of damage. Here's another view right here. You see him feel it, and then the tire comes apart before he gets to the corner.
I really don't think it hurt the car that much. He just kind of scraped down the wall. His crew was a little slow getting him going, getting him back out, but I don't think the car's hurt.
This will get these guys in their window here. We've completed 46 laps. We'll complete 47 this time. This may be the only pit stop these guys will need.
So Mikey Kyle brings the field onto pit road. Now we go to Wendy Venerini.
Ty Dillon having a great start in his second ARCA start of the season. He told his dad, Mike Dillon, who of course is son-in-law to Richard Childress, and Ty is grandson to Richard Childress. He said, "Dad, you got to stay off the radio because you're walking over everyone else." As Ty comes to a stop, it's four tires, 1 pound in the left front, half a pound out of the right front, and down on the track bar, three quarters around on the right side. He's been loose in the middle on both of those turns, and it's going to be a good stop for the 31. Let's head over to Jim.
Well, you may expect not a whole lot of changes here for the race leader, the 25 entering the Motorsports Toyota at Mikey Kyle. The Westlake, Louisiana driver, very happy with the setup. His race strategist is John Quinn, worked for a lot of years at Roush Fenway in the truck series. On the box is crew chief Kevin Reed. Very, very small pressure adjustment, four tires and fuel, and they're gone. They might have lost the lead, though.
Yeah, real close call.
Steve Arpin possibly may have gotten the lead off pit road.
Mike Dillon spots for Bowyer. And if you ever get a scanner to trace to the racetrack, you want to listen to Dillon because he is quite entertaining. And I could see why his son might say, "Dad, you got to get off the radio."
I asked him if he was going to be spotting. He said, "No, we've got Andy Houston who spots for Austin Dillon in the truck series. Andy's going to spot us. Are you going to be on the pit box?" He said, "No, we have Cale Gayle on the pit box as well as Danny Stockman, Austin Dillon's crew chief." I said, "What are you going to do?" He said, "I'm going to sit up in the grandstands." Wendy.
Well, that's exactly where you were going, Phil. He said the same thing to me. He was going to sit in the grandstands. We know Richard Childress is in the ARCA garage. He's actually on the 31 hauler of Tim George Jr., teammate to Ty Dillon in the 41. So Richard Childress on the hauler, dad Mike Dillon in the stands. You know you got the family watching over Ty. This 18-year-old definitely has a lot of pressure on his shoulders.
So the lead lap cars made their way onto pit road. Now some of the lap down cars are going to head down to pit road and have service done to their vehicles. Well, a few weeks ago, the ARCA community lost a true friend and a true supporter. Randy Morse, the vice president for RE/MAX, passed away Sunday, September 5th at his home in Denver, Colorado. Morse, who in his role as a vice president at RE/MAX International Incorporated, directed the company's marketing involvement in the ARCA Racing Series, and a good friend lost at the age of 58. Coverage of the ARCA Racing Series on Speed is brought to you by Burger King. We remind you to have it your way. And by Ansel, for over 100 years, the world leader in hand protection. And by the new Can-Am Commander side-by-side vehicle. Lucky Dog goes to the 0-2 of Darrell Hart.
We see Darrell a lot in the Can-Am Pro Series West Division.
Darrell actually from Canada, but comes down and runs the West Series.
Kenny Schrader's involved with that operation. Kenny helping field that car as well as his crew chief, Donnie Richeson.
You want to know what a racetrack will do to your community? Guys, I just look around this joint. They are building a casino over here. You got every kind of restaurant imaginable coming in. You got hotels down here. Got a new soccer stadium. Cabela's. I mean, this is a little city in right outside the city limits here. What a wonderful facility.
Back in 2001, when we first came here, there was nothing out here but the racetrack.
And you drive down the interstate out there and you look over, and it's just amazing to see this facility sitting over here and what they're doing around here. This is going to be some kind of place when they get finished with it.
Want to take a look at the Messina Wildlife Management race report. Our recap out in front, Mikey Kyle and Steve Arpin again start on the pole, and a little bit of bottlenecking behind them.
Yeah. Casey Roderick with a problem on initial start, loses an engine.
Two up front continue to battle side by side. Our first caution came out for the 26. Brad Smith gets sideways coming out of turn two.
A little innocent spin there. Nobody makes any contact with Brad.
Lap 24, engine expired on that 29 of Chad Finley.
And one of the best cars we had in this race. Had worked his way up into the top five. Short day.
Our second caution was the 58 of Chad Hockenbrough getting into the wall in turn three.
And Hockenbrough was running great. He'd come up through the field, passed a lot of cars, run the top five, then had a right front tire failure.
After 50 laps, Mikey Kyle out front. We've had two lead changes. Those were under caution. Average speed just over 131 miles an hour.
And we're halfway.
And we are halfway. So now, because the pit window was between 60 and 70, everyone could make it to the end.
Yeah. Yeah, this is never, I got to fail pit again.
Yeah, these guys will look at their tires and make sure their tire wear looks okay. Sometimes you can be a little aggressive with your camber air pressure and hurt that tire wear, but they know they can go at least about 45 laps.
But we never know about Billy Venturini. He might have something up his sleeve now about pitting again or something.
Kyle and Arpin. Mikey Kyle back to the gas quickly. He gets out front.
Remember, in the ARCA Racing Series, we do not have the shootout-style double-fall restarts. Lap cars are on the inside, lead lap cars on the outside.
Ty Dillon in the 31 back there in the third spot.
And a good indication of horsepower is restarts. It's like a drag race. And the guy that's got a lot of power can get away. And look at Frank. Ooh, Frank.
Kimmel clearing the 31 of Dillon and now trying to get by the 81 of Craig Ghost.
That's Tim George.
Tim George in the 31.
He's a lap car right now. Ty Dillon right now running in the third spot.
And smoke coming out of turn number four. It looks like we had another engine expire. This time Brian Silas in the 11.
No caution flag as of yet. There's the smoke out of the Andy Hillenburg car right there, own car.
Andy, big race next week at Rockingham Speedway. If you're in the area, please come out. What a great racetrack. I know, Darrell, you had a lot of success at that racetrack.
Love that track. I wouldn't mind at all seeing us race here again. And Andy has done an amazing job of bringing that race back alive, just like they did at North Wilkesboro. That race they had up there a few weeks ago really opened a lot of eyes.
Justin Marks in the 32. Chad McCumming in the 1, making their way up through the field.
Phil, I think that's a big mistake that we've made through the years, over the last several years, losing a lot of our short tracks. I really think that's the backbone of our sport. That's where young talent can really go and be competitive. And I think it really made a mistake when we started moving away from some of the short tracks.
How about when we go to Bristol and Richmond and Martinsville, places like that, the crowds that come, 160,000 plus to Bristol.
Yeah, I used to love the short tracks because you could get the local hometown hero. And he'd get a chance to drive a cup car or back then a Busch car. And he got to show his talents, showcase his talents. People like Tommy Houston or Jack Ingram or Sam Arter, any of those guys back in the day that really stepped up, and it's how you knew who they were.
Battle for eighth between Justin Marks and Chad McCumby. McCumby has reeled in that 32 of Marks.
Chad's reeled off 3 top 10 finishes in a row coming in here. All 8th place finishes, but that team's on the rise.
Wendy.
Chad McCumby was terrible loose off before the first run of this race, barely hanging on to the race car, according to Chad McCumby. He wanted wedge and track bar. His crew chief, Cal Beaupre, didn't want to over-adjust. They did one round down on the track bar, 2 in the left rear, but just no grip for Chad McCumby. It looks like the adjustments were spot on because he is definitely gaining some positions out there on the racetrack. Jim?
Well, the point leader, Patrick Shelter, came in the 4th position, went out 4th on the restart. They didn't do a bunch of changes. He said the car was getting a bit tight in the beginning of the run. Now center off, he said it was a little snug, so they did a little bit of adjustment with 1 round out with the 4-tire change and, again, adjustment on the rear for Sheltrup. He said nothing on the radio. They're just talking about his race pace, and they are in it for the long runs here. And Sheltrup, again, staying top 5 after that solid pit stop.
I tell you, guy, I think you need to keep an eye on, and only because of a lot of experience in the pits, and they know how to make the right adjustments when the time comes. That 41 car, Dylan, when you put the kind of experience behind a kid like that in the car, and he's running 3rd right now, I wouldn't count him out. He's got a pretty fast car.
Steve Arpin still within 0.4 of a second from his teammate Mikey Kyle out in front of the field. There's Ty Dillon in the 41.
And Ty had the fastest lap on the racetrack that last time. He was about almost 0.3 of a second faster than Mikey Kyle.
Well, when you come to these super speedways where the speeds are so high, having a crew chief down there that has experience, knows what adjustments to make to that car to get the driver a little bit more comfortable and get him up near the front, keep an eye on this kid.
Ty Dillon running in the 3rd spot. Mikey Kyle continues to lead our championship competitors. Patrick Sheltra in 4th, Craig Gose in 7th, and Tom Hessert running 12th. Right now we've got 12 cars on the lead lap. Stay with us. October 9th, Formula One on Speed will return to the land of the rising sun here with the precision of a samurai. The drivers will attack one of the most challenging and fastest tracks on the circuit, Suzuka. Don't miss the Formula One Japanese Grand Prix live Saturday, October 9th at 1:30 a.m. Eastern, 10:30 p.m. Pacific, exclusively on Speed.
You know, we've raced there, actually, with the Cup car. That's a great racetrack. I think Larry Skinner actually won that race.
Yep.
I think Skinner won a couple of those races over there overseas, right?
He did.
40 laps to go. Mikey Kyle continuing to set the pace here in Kansas. Steve Arpin running 2nd. Ty Dillon, the young man in the 41, running 3rd now.
Pretty exciting when Ty Dillon won the K&M Pro Series East Division race at Gresham Motorsports Park a few weeks ago.
Dillon boys are tearing it up, man.
They really have figured a few things out here in the stock car world. Austin Dillon having success in the Camping World Trucks, won at Iowa earlier this year.
And last week at Las Vegas.
And
Austin Dillon.
Yep. Listen, cashed in.
When you see a black 3 win a race in any of these series, and particularly when they're with the connection to RCR, that gets people pumped up right there. That's a big, big deal.
And he's a nice young man, too. He's a
great kid.
Going to college right now, High Point University.
Yep.
2 teammates running 1 and 2. Talk about the Dillon family. They both sat on the pole in Iowa, one in the trucks and one in the ARCA Racing Series on the same day. How about that? A little wiggle out of Steve Arpin as he's closing in on the 25 of Mikey Kyle.
Yeah, Steve's been all over his teammate, Mikey Kyle. You hear that Chip Revlimeter kick in there.
Here comes Arpin working that throttle, man, trying to get some grip up off the corner back there. Looks like he's got a nose underneath him, but can't do anything with him.
Fred goes. Right now, one of our point contenders gets another spot, gets by the 16 left of your screen, Joey Coulter. Here goes a battle for the lead, side by side.
Mikey Kyle on the inside, Steve Arpin trying to make the move on the outside.
And while these two guys are racing hard here amongst themselves, here comes the 41 and the 60. They're closing in fast, too.
They remain side by side. That's a battle for the lead. Arpin on the outside looks as though he's going to take the top spot away from his teammate. So Mikey Kyle drops back to second.
Well, that outside looked pretty good out there, DW.
I like that. We haven't seen many people venture up there today, but probably just now getting enough rubber up there and getting it blown off, cleaned off enough that they can do it.
So Steve Arpin out in front. Three wins on the 2010 season.
Here comes Shelter. I'm telling you, he's on a move right now. He's just going by Dillon there.
That's a battle for the third position right there, side by side.
Dillon back in the gas as they cross the start-finish line. He's trying to stay in front of Patrick Shelter.
Shelter's on the bottom, got that thing hooked up around that white line. Dillon's up there on the high side a little bit. Looks like the bottom's going to prevail.
Shelter's car looked really good down there in the bottom, that corner.
He's been methodically, slowly just kind of working his way toward the front. And here he is in third place now. I like the way he's doing his job today.
He has a lot of experience in his pit box, too. John Wolf, who's a lot of cup experience and some nationwide experience on the pit box for Patrick Shelter.
That just means so much when it comes to setup, changes you need to make during the race to get the car good for the driver. That really is important.
One of the other things that Patrick Shelter has done this year is he's had driving coaches. He's had guys helping him out with experience at different racetracks, one of those being Ted Musgrave at one point in time. Former champion in the Camping World Truck Series. Out in front, it's Steve Arpin here in Kansas. Download the new free app for your iPhone. Keep speed at your fingertips and fuel your passion for racing between events with speed on your phone. Get the latest stats, results, videos, and news as soon as they become available. Download the app from iTunes now.
Three-way battle right there, four position, the 32 of Justin Marks, Chad McCombie in the one, Joey Coulter in the 16. Chad gets hung in behind the lap car of Rob Jones, the 23 car.
Good thing this is a good, nice wide speedway, because these guys, they find themselves in some very precarious situations.
Joey Coulter in front of Chad McCombie. Again out front, it's Steve Arpin. He has put 1 second between himself and teammate Mikey Kyle. Patrick Shelter back there, 1.5 seconds. There's your race leader. Steve Arpin made the pass on the outside. Was able to get by his teammate on the outside of turns one and two to get the lead.
Yeah, I don't know what they did to the 25 car there of Mikey Kyle on that pit stop, but his car doesn't seem to be as good this run as it was when they started to race. Got Shelford chasing him down. Looks like he's going to be able to make the pass here in a lap or two.
And the problem with you saying not as good on this run, this is probably the last run. There's not any changes he can make.
Here he goes. There goes Shelter down the back. Got a run on the Mikey here. The slow car is going to box him in. He's going to have to fall in behind him, but definitely much faster.
It's Tom Birdie in the 15. Another one of the Venturini Motorsports entries.
You know, one thing we failed to mention, that both the Cunningham Motorsports cars of Tom Hessert and Dakota Armstrong were both penalized for speeding on pit road. They had to restart this race from the back. And right now they're running 11th for Tom Hessert, 12th for Dakota Armstrong, the last two cars on the lead lap.
Looks to me like that 25 car has gotten way too tight. See him in the middle of the corner, and the car just seems to push up the racetrack. It's killing his straightaway speed and really opening a door here for Shelter to make a nice run on him.
And that really is a typical of this racetrack, DW, for this racetrack to get tighter and tighter and tighter. You know, that's the thing. If you start out really good, chances are you may get tight as you went on. Mikey Kyle may have come in the pits and said, hey, no changes, the thing's so good right now. And as the racetrack tightens up, it may have come to Steve Arpin.
Well, and back to the crew chief. That's the guy that's got to know a little bit about what's going on here, about what kind of changes to make to the car, listening to the driver, but also thinking about that very thing, Phil. This thing's going to tighten up a little bit. I might want to adjust it so we are ahead of the curve.
Battle for second. Looks like Shelter is going to take second away from Mikey Kyle. Just behind these two, it's the 41 of Ty Dillon, Wendy.
when we saw Patrick Sheltra pass the 41 of Ty Dillon, the radio communication was pretty hectic for the 41. And for Ty, he came over the radio and said they had no water pressure. There was some miscommunication whether he had it or didn't have water pressure. His temps are at 220 right now. They said it might be hung open. Ty did report that the car is pushing water. Richard Childress at that point got on the radio and said, "You're running a great race, Ty. Just focus." Jim?
Well, DW nailed it. The 25 machine of Mikey Kyle said they're extremely tight in the middle. So what they've done, again, they can't do a whole lot on pit road, but they did instruct their driver, Mikey Kyle, to turn the bead blower off on the right rear tire. So we'll see how things heat up on that right rear bead, but that's the adjustment they want to make now to try to get that car to handle a little bit better. Very, very tight in the middle right now in the 2.5.
Yeah, you turn that bead blower off, that will allow the right rear tire to build a little more pressure. It's almost like taking wedge out of the car. It'll get that right rear tire a little stiffer, if you will, like a change of spring, help the car turn a little bit. Plus, the driver can help that some, too, by driving it, changing his driving style a little bit. Maybe driving a little harder and not push the car so hard up off the corner.
You want to try to stay off that right front tire, because the more that car pushes, the more that air pressure is going to build up in that right rear, in that right front tire.
Steve Arpin, 1.3 seconds over Patrick Sheltra. We saw Ty Dillon, a little bit of steam rolling out of that race car. Stay with us. October 9th, the ARCA Racing Series heads to Rockingham. With the championship battle still undecided, it will all come down to a three-way battle in the last event of the year. Who will come out on top? Find out when the ARCA Racing Series hits the track for the season finale in Rockingham, October 9th at 1:30 Eastern, live on Speed.
Phil, that's the kind of track where these guys put on a great show. That's right in their wheelhouse, like a Salem, a little bit bigger. Some of the small racetracks are really, really good on.
There's one of our contenders right there getting another position. Craig Ghost gets by Frank Kimmel. That's another 5 points right there. You see Patrick Sheltra right now 35 points ahead by virtue of the fact he's running second right now. Craig Ghost now running fifth. And Tom Hesert now running 11th. So 60 points right now, the top three. And this thing isn't over yet. But Darrell, that championship last year went down to the very last lap.
Yeah, it will. When they're that close, Phil, it will. 60 points is certainly not too much to overcome.
12 spots. Spin on the racetrack. Justin Marks got sideways, looked like. And straightened back out as we have Arpin still out in front by 1.3 seconds. Again, Arpin setting a blistering pace now. He took it away from his teammate, Mikey Kyle. Patrick Sheltra has been able to move up into the second spot, and he's closing the gap on Steve Arpin. So
let's see if we can see what happened.
Just the end of, I think, what just happened.
Guys, we're getting down close to 20 laps to go in this race.
Oh, this thing has flown by. I mean, very few yellows, and these guys are really just hustling these cars around here today.
There's Justin Marks right there in the 32. He's still being shown up in the seventh position right now. Justin got his first win of his career earlier this year at West Palm Beach on the road course in the rain.
Yep.
ARCA Racing Series is probably the most versatile series in the world.
When I saw him there in the opening running at DeCoin on the dirt in Springfield, I mean, there's so many racetracks that these guys go to, historic, great racetracks that they've been going to for years. And John Markham, when he started ARCA, he knew what he was doing. He built a great series.
And a great story how this series started. I mean, Bill France Sr. wrote him a note and said, "Hey, stick with it. We need you out there."
Yeah, Bill learned maybe from the Talladega debacle, you know, in 69 when everybody said they're going to walk out.
Yeah.
But I think Bill figured out right then, we got to have backups. You know, it's like when Goodyear, you know, came, maybe there was a problem at Goodyear. He went and got Hoosier involved. So Bill was always looking for a backup, and this was his backup series.
There's a battle right there. Tom Hesert trying to get that 10th spot away from Joey Coulter. Looks like he has it. That's another 5 points for Tom Hesert.
Hesert trying to make his way back after the penalty on pit road. Again, too fast exiting pit road put him at the back of the lead lap cars.
But that car's just not handling very good, Phil. You hear out of the throttle forever and just really coasting through the corner almost.
So Steve Arpin making his way through some of the slower lap traffic, still has a 1 second lead over Patrick Sheltra, who is leading the championship point standings. Right after the conclusion of this race, make sure to stay tuned to Speed for NASCAR Race Hub with Steve Burns. They'll update the Richard Childress Racing appeal situation, which took place yesterday. Bob Dillner will have a report from here in Kansas, and we'll get Jimmy Spencer's take on, well, pretty much everything racing.
Maybe some other things.
He has a take on about everything that is involved in racing. There's the difference between one and two.
Battle's closing up here a little bit, DW. They're inside of 3/4 of a second now.
Guarantee you, when you're the point leader, this is exactly what you want to see. You want to see that guy that's leading this race getting bigger and bigger, getting closer and closer. It's been a great day for Sheltra. Done a good job today. Bring her home.
Steve Arpin out front. And the 60 of Patrick Sheltra running second.
One of the guys that I've been watching, that's Russ Duggar right there, and that's Mario Gosling's Excel construction car. I tell you, Russ has only run a couple times this year. His last time out, he finished 14th at Texas. What a great run he has going right now, running in the ninth spot.
Top tens, man. When you haven't raced much, go to a racetrack, you always think, man, if I could just get a top 10.
Well, that 14th place finish at Texas. Texas was actually the third race of the season. So, I mean, that's a long time ago when he was in the seat of the car.
Little wiggle by Arpin up off of four. Patrick Sheltra's all over him.
Oh, and across the infield, the 23 goes sliding, almost making contact. That's Rob Jones.
Looked like he may have made contact with the inside barrier back there.
Slides into the wall, and the field will be slowed once again. This is just the third time.
A lot of contact.
He made serious contact.
Yeah, sure did. No safer barrier back there that far off the racetrack. Rob came into this race 17th in points. He has a memorial on the hood. He's, as I mentioned earlier, he's a pilot for UPS, and UPS lost a plane, the first fatalities they ever had, as long as they've been in business, and there's a memorial on the hood of that car. But it's going to be a short day, I think, for Rob.
Strategy, 13 laps. Is that enough to come in and change tires?
I'll tell you right now, if I'm in that 55 car, I'm coming to the pits because that car's not handling very good right now.
Give up the lead?
Got a little bit high right there.
Yeah, he did, and he goes down.
Rob Jones did win across the racetrack.
Catches that inside wall back. Rick, I don't know. I guess if you're points racing, maybe not, but golly gee, that car, the handle's gone off of it. I'm not sure.
That was right in front of Tom Hesser.
Yeah.
That spin was one of our point contenders.
We've only got 12 on the lead lap. So, but the thing about this is,
it's single file restarts, though. That's right. I mean, they don't get the double files like you get in
tough. That's right.
So,
if you're Tom Hesser right now, you're back running in the 10th position. I think you have to come. There's only 12 cars in the lead lap.
There's no question from the top three or four back, you should come. But I'm not so sure if I was the 55, I wouldn't come as well.
I think I would come, too. I'm not sure that I wouldn't come, period, here. We know these things slow down 2 to 2.5 seconds when you get some laps on these tires. You can pass a lot of people in 3 or 4 laps and get the goodie off the tires.
Right now, the crew chief is talking to the driver. How long do you think this is going to take to get it cleaned up? They're looking at the car on the back straightaway. They got to determine how many laps they think they're going to have left when they come to green. If it gets down inside of 6 or 7, I'm not so sure. But right now,
I got to come for tires.
And so you guys are making the call.
We're drivers.
The hard left-hand turn. It looks as though we're going to see our leader make that move, and everyone's going to follow him. Wendy?
On my end of pit road, it's going to be Ty Dillon getting his tires. He's been super tight in the center, then has to give it so much wheel, it snaps loose on him. For that loose condition, they're going to go down on the track bar one round. 2 pounds air pressure adjustment in all the tires. It was very chaotic. Oh, as he slides to a stop in his stall, Ty Dillon just barely catches the edge of his pit road out of his pit stall. It is going to be 4 tires. But quick air pressure adjustments here on the 41 pit stall. It was very chaotic, Jim.
4 tires for our race leader, the 55 of Steve Arpin. They talked to the crew on the radio, so we cannot afford not to pit. We'd get beat if we didn't come down pit road. He set the stage. He also came out on pit road a bit better than Patrick Sheltra, who's going to lose a few spots by also taking 4 tires in that 60 machine.
How about Ty Dillon going to win the battle off pit road?
Well, and how about Craig Gose also getting off of pit road? It looks like third. So Craig Gose makes a huge change. Mm. The 52 had to come in at an angle because there was a car right in front of him. He was negotiating to go by, so the Kyle Fowler had to come in at a different angle.
So we see what happened here to Sheltra, because must have had a problem on the left front
Yeah, having to
slow to drive around. Ooh, whoa. Almost contact with Tom Hessert.
Almost had a problem on the right front.
Very close call between two championship contenders.
That 41 car, though, he beat them out big time.
Great pit work by the RCR guys.
Can he be strong for the final 10 laps of racing? That is the big question now. Yeah.
I think these boys just saw the race get away from them right here. That 41 car up front, I believe that's your man.
We'll see if Ty Dillon can get to victory lane at Kansas Speedway. That is happening right after the break here on Speed. Welcome back to Kansas Speedway for the Kansas 150, the second to last race for the ARCA Racing Series. And things are heating up in our points championship battle. After all of our points contenders came to pit road, here is how they came off. Right now, our point leader coming in is running sixth on the racetrack, and that has tightened everything up.
Yeah, look, he's 5 points right now ahead of Craig Gost and 10 points ahead of Tom Hessert. Top three guys, DW, 10 points apart.
Yeah, Patrick had a problem, just a little bit of a slow stop, and came in running second, went back out running sixth. Not what you want to see with 10 to go.
Tom Hessert may have been the big winner. He came in 10th. And comes out fifth.
Yeah, things are heating up.
Good time for a good pit stop, I think.
Well, I think the big winner is going to be the 41 car, Dillon, though, because I think that car up front, you put that kid out front in clean air, might just be the guy to pull away from these other guys.
They'll give him the one to go sign when they come back to the start finish line. And again, as you mentioned, Ty Dillon winning the race off of pit road, so he will be out in front. There's the points as they run on the racetrack. Again, a 5-point deficit for Craig Gost. Tom Hessert just 10 points back. Wendy.
And that makes a big difference if we were to leave Kansas with an extra 5 points that he came into this race with. Tom Hessert right now gained a lot of positions on that racetrack by pitting with two tires. His crew chief, John Munson, made that call. Keep in mind, the last time down pit road, they were penalized, so they had some ground to make up. This is one way to make up ground, putting on two tires in these final laps for Tom Hessert. 5 points can make a big difference when we get to Rockingham. Jim?
And his teammate Dakota Armstrong was running right with him in 11th at the time of the caution. Hessert was up to 10th, but unfortunately for the 22 machine, a horrible pit stop. They wanted to go right, two right side tires, but they wanted to put a rubber in the right rear, couldn't get it in. Now they've gone two additional pit stops on pit road for Dakota Armstrong, who is 20 points out of fifth place. A big blow for this 22 machine.
One of the problems, they had a bad pit stop. Take a look at the rear tire changer here. As he comes around, whoa, a little slick. You know, and surprisingly enough, the paint on pit road can be slicker than the asphalt.
And this is probably a second pit stop, because he came back in to try to put that rubber, and you see nobody on the right front. But Dakota is going to be able to drive all the way up to the lead lap car. Single file restarts here in the last 10 laps in the ARCA Racing Series.
That will help out these point contenders. Again, Ty Dillon, Steve Arpin, Craig Gost, 1-2-3 on the restart. Mikey Kyle, who led from the pole early on. And it looks as though they're going to send him around again. The lights coming back on the
one
pace car.
Yeah, they waved off this restart here. Going to be one more time.
Take a look at our Messina race summary. After 91 of our 100 scheduled laps, Ty Dillon out in front. We had three lead changes between four different drivers. Our average speed now just under 130 miles an hour. I mean, we've been fairly caution-free. This was just the third caution of the race.
You know, right now, Steve Arpin, he knew he had his teammate, Mikey Kyle, the 25, to outrun. But now, all of a sudden, here's the 41 car. He hasn't seen the 41 car this entire race. He doesn't know how good that 41 car. You know, it has to be some anxious moments for Steve Arpin.
I just really think when you put a kid like that up front, and he didn't have anything in front of him to worry about, I believe he's going to run some really fast laps, and I think he could be the guy that could go to victory circle.
And, you know, his brother won last week.
And that's, he's got a lot of pressure on him. Plus, he's got Dillon telling him what to do. He's got dad telling him what to do. He's got RC telling him what to do. He's got the crew chief telling him. There is no excuse for not knowing what to do.
And he can't very well turn his radio off and turn his dad off, because he's got to listen to everybody else. Danny Stockman and Cale Gayle. Got to listen to Grandpa. He's a car owner.
That's right.
We've got a lot of people talking with him. Again, make sure to stay with us right here on Speed. Coming up next, it's NASCAR Race-Up. Steve Burns. They'll update you on that Richard Childress Racing appeal that took place yesterday. Bob Dillner will have a report from right here in Kansas.
And so much more.
And
a full
so,
hour's worth of
so
action on the Race Hub.
And how do you think Jimmy Spencer will come down on all of that?
Well, I think he'll have an opinion. We see Rick Crawford back there.
Yeah. That's Richard RC. Childress. That's Chevrolet hat.
Well, we got a crowd here.
He's kicking back. He's sitting down for the end of this one. Rick Crawford, he's standing up for the end of this one.
All right, a good restart here, and that could be all over, boys. Let's see what happens.
Ty Dillon bringing the field back out of four.
He gave up on the starts. No, you can't give up the outside like that.
Got to stay up against that outside wall. You mentioned it already earlier, Darryl.
Oh, man. That's just a rookie mistake.
Steve Arpin jumps to the outside, takes the lead. Here comes Mikey Kyle on the outside for second.
Trying to get by. Side by side with Craig Gose.
Craig Gose running for a championship. He's battling for third now. Ty Dillon, as we have just seven laps remaining, he's trying to get back and maybe overtake Steve Arpin, who took that spot away on the start.
Yeah, I believe he can do it. His car really got through the middle of three and four really good. He's closing fast.
Looking to the inside. Battle for the lead. Takes it away in turn number one.
You know, I just wonder if that was that situation on these fresh tires with a rev limiter kicking in the ignition. It looked like Ty Dillon, looked like the 55 just put the brakes on him. Ty Dillon just drove around him.
Ty Dillon takes the top spot back. Wendy.
Well, right before we went back green, Richard Childress, of course, the granddad of Ty Dillon, reminded him where he was supposed to start that race. They also reminded Ty, protect the outside, then protect the bottom. It was a rookie mistake. According to the team, they all just threw up their hands on that restart, but it only took a lap for Ty Dillon to grab that lead back from Steve Arpin.
Yeah, I know what he probably said over the radio. Y'all leave me alone. I know what I'm doing.
I bet he was scared after he lost that lead, and he thought, I'd better get it back.
Let's watch this now. I just wondered if this rev limiter has any play in what happened and how the 55 of Steve Arpin lost this lead.
Oh, I don't know, Phil. I think that 41 is just that much faster.
Four laps to go for Ty Dillon.
Here it is right here now. This is the restart.
And you see how Ty just pulled it out, and that was just such a rookie mistake.
Now let's listen to this. Listen to the onboard right now. Listen to this rev limiter chip. You hear it? Just after the start finish line, the chip cuts in, and the 41 is going to drive bomb on the inside. DW,
yes, I think
he had too much gear for fresh tires.
He did. You're exactly right, Phil, and that's how he made that pass so easy.
Three laps of racing to go for Ty Dillon out in front of Steve Arpin.
Now Craig goes all over the back of the 55 of Steve Arpin.
Yeah, right, that 55 about in the second half of this race just has not been that good. I mean, after all, he is running second, but car's not near as fast as it was early.
And I think that car would get better as the tires wear down. But the problem is, DW, we have three laps to go.
Yeah.
The tires aren't going to get worn down and slow down.
Yeah, you got a good car on the long run. Unfortunately, the long run is not going to help you now.
That's
two
the situation.
Laps.
They had a gear in there for a long run, and unfortunately, they're going to have a little sprint here at the end, and it's going to cost them the race.
Two laps to go. Ty Dillon out in front now by almost 2 seconds over Steve Arpin. Craig Gose running in the third spot. Mikey Kyle is fourth. Patrick Sheltra is fifth. 5 points per position in the ARCA Racing Series. And so there are 10 points going to change between Craig Gose and Patrick Sheltra as they're running on the track.
Wonder if Ty has called in and told him about the water pressure lately.
I hope he's not looking at the gauges.
It
right
doesn't
now.
Matter now.
White flag goes in the air one more time around Kansas Speedway.
How many first-time winners did you say we had this
11,
year?
We had 11, and it looks like we might make it 12.
We're headed right towards 12 right here.
Ty Dillon going down the backstretch now. Less than 3/4 of a mile remain for Ty Dillon.
High school senior, DW.
No, it's just amazing. These kids, they get in these race cars, they go out there and drive like they've been driving for 20 years.
Grandson of Richard Childress comes out of turn number four. Ty Dillon is going to go to victory lane.
Whoopee!
In Kansas.
Yeehaw.
Steve Arpin will come home second. Craig Gose with a great point day and a top three finish. Mikey Kyle, who led so much of this race, finishes fourth. Our point leader, Patrick Sheltra, fifth. Tom Hessert, his closest pursuer, right behind him.
Boy, it's going to be tight going to Rockingham, boys. The point race is something.
There's grandfather,
yeah,
Richard
Childress.
Yeah, look
at RC.
Big smile.
RC said didn't go so good on Wednesday, but sure did go nice on
Thursday.
Thursday.
You, the two races that his grandsons have run, the past two races, Austin Dillon won at Las Vegas on Saturday, and now Ty Dillon will go to victory lane here in Kansas.
Ah, nothing to it. Piece of cake.
Well, the success continues for the Dillon family, and great to see Ty Dillon with success here.
The great news is Ty will be with us at Rockingham for the final race here in the ARCA Racing Series. And as of right now, full-time next year in the ARCA Racing Series for Ty Dillon.
That's what his dad had said, as he looks like he might do an interesting burnout here using the wall.
Put her up against the wall. Childress was telling me that when Austin came in, he said, asked him about running the three. He said, "Papaw, I'd like to be the one to run the three." And Childress said, "How could I say no?"
No kidding. How could you say no to that? Wendy.
And on the radio, the response was, "Austin and Ty are making me look good. What does it feel to get an ARCA win with 18-year-old Ty Dillon now?"
I'm telling you, them Dillon boys, they're something else. And just a pleasure working for RCR and this whole organization and all these guys. And that good pit stop on the end put us out front. That's all we needed.
Did you think that restart was the end of it for Ty?
Heck no, that kid can drive a race car with the best of them. And second ARCA career start, and them boys are awesome, I'm telling you. Be watching for them here in the next couple years in Cup, because they're going to be coming.
All right, I would agree with that. Cheers around here, and they reminded Ty, go ahead and do a burnout, celebrate, but don't ruin that nose. We got to race that race car next week.
Yeah, that's what Mike Dillon was telling us earlier. He said, well, as long as he doesn't mess this car up, we're going to take it to Rockingham for the last race of the season. He didn't mess anything up. Made it all the way to the front after a great pit stop, and then having to battle back from maybe a little bit slower restart than he wanted, he is going to victory lane. We'll hear from him next here on Speed. Welcome back to the Kansas 150. He's already made it to victory lane. Let's go there with Wendy Venerini.
18 years old, a high school senior, and he's about to get doused with Gatorade in victory lane for his first career win in the ARCA Series, following up from his E-Series win at Gresham Motorsports Park. Congratulations from the team. Ty, how good does it feel to win in ARCA now?
It's awesome. These guys have worked so hard all week, all year. We started out with a rough year, and the end of the year has just been incredible with a win at Gresham in the E-Series. And our second ARCA race to win a race, it's awesome. It's just a testament to what these guys have done. Me and Austin have done real good job with Stockman this year. He's the man. It shows how well he sets up these cars, and these guys are awesome. And I got to thank Carl Chevrolet for coming on board and helping us out.
Earlier in the race, you said you were pushing water. You were worried about water pressure. How much did that concern you?
There for a little bit, but after a while, the temp never went anywhere. And the guys just calmed me down a lot, which I got to thank Andy Houston a lot for that. And I guess it just made it to the end, and I'm real happy.
Now, talk about that restart. Did you think you had it lost at that point when Arpin and you battled it out?
Well, Stockman before the restart said, just never give up, and I never did. I messed up on the restart. I had bad restarts all day. I got to work on that. But I never gave up. The car was awesome. And once we got in clean air, this thing was awesome.
Are you due back at school on Monday to give a report?
I might have to go back tomorrow. But yeah, we'll be celebrating with everybody at school.
All right. Well, Richard Childress in victory lane to hug his grandson, Ty Dillon, on his first ARCA win. Of course, Clint Boyer made his way to victory lane to congratulate him. RC, congratulations. Another Dillon in victory lane.
Yeah, it's going to get expensive, I think. But it's great. Ty, we know he can get the job done. I'm so proud of him. And this whole group, Stockman, that bunch of guys, they did such a great job. And best thing that's happened to me all week. So, you know, the sun is shining today.
It sure is. Richard Childress, happy. A great way to start the week here at the Kansas Speedway. Despite everything going on, Richard Childress is a happy man in victory lane in the ARCA Series. Jim.
And Steve Arpin is standing by, and we're just talking about the exciting things he's doing with Mike's Hard Pick Lemonade. But, man, talk about what you could have had at the finish there and what wasn't to the second-place run. You said you were fighting that race car.
Yeah, Ty kind of caught me off guard there. I thought we had a really good restart that last restart and got by him on the high side. And we had a really good car all day. The Mike's Hard Lemonade Toyota, it was good. We had to tighten it up a little bit in the middle of the race there, and we went out and got the lead and just trying everything we could. But that last run after we took our last four, we were just way too loose there at the end.
You threw everything at it. How about that rev limiter? Did it come in at the right time you wanted it to?
I was swearing at that thing. It's a good thing we didn't have you guys weren't listening there a bunch, because, man, I was swearing at that thing going down the straightaway sometimes. It's really good. We got off the corner really good. We're just short on a little bit of speed at the end of the straightaway. That's where Ty Dillon beat us. He did a great job. It's been it's been fun, but now we're really excited. Everything we're doing, Mike's Hard Lemonade, they're donating $250,000 to breast cancer research in support of all their efforts there. It's a real personal battle for them. They lost a family member, if you want to call it that, a couple years ago to the disease. So we're really excited with everything we're doing there, and we're trying to do our part, and we're doing an eBay auction online. You can get on to stevearpin.net, and we're doing an eBay auction. We got lots of cool stuff. Lots of Dale Jr. stepping up and helping us out. Carl Edwards, we got some of their diecast, my diecast, some Junior Motorsports crew shirts, our crew shirts. We got all sorts of stuff on there, so check it out.
Thanks, Steve. Guys?
Yeah, you know, it was kind of funny. Ty Dillon made the comment. Danny Stockman said to me, don't give up. I think that's when the mic got keyed. It was don't give up the outside line on the restart.
I like what Childress said. This is going to get expensive.
Grandfather knows that it gets expensive when the grandsons are doing well in racing. How about that? A big hug in victory lane. Richard Childress and Ty Dillon. Coverage of the ARCA Racing Series on Speed is brought to you by Mothers. There's no shine like Mothers. By Messina Wildlife Management. Stop animal damage with Messina Wildlife Management. And by Aaron's. Everyone's a lucky dog and Aaron's. So Ty Dillon continues to celebrate in victory lane. He's not running the full season, but we do look at our points with one race remaining. We came in, there was 20 points separating the top three, and guess what?
How about that? 20 points again going to Rockingham. But, hey, there's no accident that those three guys are up in the points because all three of those guys came here to Kansas needing a good run, needing a decent run, and they all finish in the top six.
Boy, going to Rockingham, that's going to be exciting. These guys are going to fight it out right to the last lap, just like last year.
Patrick Sheltra still in front. He's standing by with Jim Trado.
After his 16th top 10 finish of the season, Patrick, doing everything possible you can to win this championship. You've got the lead, but you're not satisfied right now. It seems like somebody just took away your toys or something.
Yeah, you know, we had a real dominant car in the long run. The guys did a real good job today. You know, we had that late caution there. You know, we was just sitting here talking. Probably should have took two instead of four. But, you know, you got to thank Tequesta Road and Bridge and Jones Group and Ferguson Pipe for putting us out here today and Triad, you know, for giving us a great engine. You know, just go back and one race to go. It's going to be close, but I think we'll have something for in Rockingham.
There was a little time between Salem and this event. Now next weekend we'll ride to Rockingham and race on a Saturday. How has it been for you managing this very, very narrow point lead?
Well, you know, you just got to be real conservative, but yet you got to still get out there and dig very hard. And, you know, that's just something we've been doing all year. We've been being consistent and everything else. So we just got to do that and take it to Rockingham and take the championship home.
And he's going to be fighting with a man standing by with Wendy Venturini.
Craig Gose, of course, is going to go into Rockingham with a little bit of battle to fight. But talk about today first. This is where you needed to be, sort of, you said.
Yeah, we struggled a little bit today. And I got to thank all the guys on the team. Everybody worked hard. We worked hard on this car all day long. Made improvements throughout the race. We were good on old tires. My guys did great pit stops, and we made a pretty good day out of a day that seemed to be kind of iffy when we started out. So I'm looking forward to going to Rockingham and trying to get this championship under our belt.
10 points separate you and Patrick Sheltra. What do you need to do when you arrive in Rockingham?
Sit on the pole. That'll put us in the lead. Can breathe a little bit easier. Get our track chaplain to send me an extra little message like he sent me earlier today. I think that helped us a little bit, and take it from there.
No doubt this is going to go all the way till we get to the end of Rockingham next week. 20 points separate these three guys.
Thanks, Wendy. Take a look at our unofficial results. Ty Dillon again grabbing his first win in the ARCA Racing Series.
A 12th different first-time winner this year in the ARCA Racing Series.
This series, this has come so far, Phil. I remember back in the day, you wouldn't see an ARCA race on television, and you wouldn't see guys give the kind of interviews. A bunch of really good young men run in this series right here. What a great future for ARCA.
Saw Chad Hockenbrough had a great car. Ends up falling out of the race after that right front tire went down. He finishes back in the 25th position. Chad Finley, one of the best cars we had here, loses an engine and finishes 30th.
We've heard from the top two in points. Let's hear from third in points. Tom Hessert is standing by with Jim Trado.
Great run for you, Tom. Talk about the gamble to get those points back. So you're only 20 out headed to Rockingham.
Yeah, just 20 points out. We didn't have our best day. Weren't the fastest. Kind of had a tough qualifying run and were mired in the back for most of the time. But my crew chief, John Monsell, made a great call. And the guys at Cunningham made a good two-tire stop. And we were able to hang on there and get six. So, you know, 20 out going into Rockingham is not too bad.
What kind of gun you bringing to Rockingham? What kind of race car?
I don't know. We're going to test there next week, and it might be this car here or the car we ran in Chicago. So we're going to find out next Thursday when I'm there, and whichever one it is, it hopefully is the right one.
It's going to be exciting, guys.
It is definitely going to be exciting. One race remaining in the 2010 season, and that will take place at Rockingham, October 9th, Saturday race, 1:30 p.m.
I like the pit strategy. One guy takes four because he doesn't want to take a chance and something happened. Another guy takes two because
he wants to take a chance.
I cannot wait for that finale next week at Rockingham. I'm telling you need to tune into that one.
It will be a great one. Again, Race Hub following us right here on Speed. Steve Burns. They'll talk about RCR and how that appeal process went yesterday, as well as what they plan to do in the future.
It didn't go as good as this race went today, that's for sure.
No, but John Middlebrook is the guy that is going to hear the case next. He's a former general manager of General Motors, if I remember right.
And I believe the 33 is a Chevrolet.
If I remember right.
We had a great battle here today. Some dominant cars. In the end, it was pit strategy that got Ty Dillon out in front. And ultimately, he drove back by for the win.